Good morning. Good morning and happy Mother's Day. Welcome to Talbot Park Baptist Church. Good to see all of you here. Especially want to welcome all our mothers who are here today. And you will see there in the bulletin, we have gifted you, made a donation on your behalf to the Baptist Women in Ministry, which is a group that's doing wonderful things all around our country to help train women who are in ministry, looking to go into ministry. And you can see the website there in the bulletin if you want to know more about them. But we are glad you're here. Do you know what the digital clock said to his mother? Look, Ma, no hands. Happy Mother's Day. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for worship together. Please join me in the call to worship. We come in the name of the one who watches over us as a mother watches over a child, who loved us before we were born, who knows us better than we know ourselves, and whose presence never leaves us. This is our God, the true mother of all people. Let us worship and give thanks. Amen. Let's stand as you're able as we sing our praise song, Cornerstone. Be seated. Let's pray together. Gracious God, the prophet Isaiah tells us that you comfort us as a mother comforts her children. And today we celebrate that promise that you care for us as we could never care for ourselves. We are grateful for your love, which we see through the women in our lives. God, this morning, we thank you for our mothers. We thank you for their patience and their wisdom, for the ways that they have made us better. Some of us had very good, loving mothers. Some of us did not. But God, today we thank you for what they gave us, both in their strengths and through their flaws. We pray not just for our own mothers, but for mothers who are in jail, separated from children, for mothers who are busy struggling to make ends meet. We pray for adoptive mothers and foster mothers, and for mothers who will never bear children of their own, but have been like mothers to us. All of these we cherish, and we pray that you will teach us to honor them, both in what we say and how we live. Mother's Day is a time for thanksgiving, but God, we also know that this is a hard day for many, that there are some in our midst this morning for whom this day is a painful reminder of a mother or children they have lost. There are some in our midst this morning who desperately wanted to be mothers but could not for one reason or another. Some who have had miscarriages or abortions and quietly bear those scars. There are some in our midst this morning who are not and have never wanted to be mothers, but who sometimes feel less worthy because we as a society define a woman's value by her fertility. Today we pray for all of these, that they may find peace in the midst of their pain. And we acknowledge the ways we contribute to their brokenness through our words and our deeds. God, this morning we all need forgiveness for the ways we have hurt you and each other. Sometimes it's intentional, sometimes it's not, but either way, we need to repent and we need to receive your grace again. And we need it, God, because we are called to participate in your good work of salvation. We're called to share the good news of what Christ has done for us. We pray this morning that we will be diligent in our work, that we will not grow weary as we seek to bring about your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. We work for justice because we believe every human life has equal value in your eyes. We pray for those we find deplorable, for those we fear, for those who mistreat us. Remind us we are not called to be served, but to serve. Help us to always follow in the footsteps of the one who laid down his life for the salvation of the world. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. I will be reading today from John chapter 17, verses 6 through 19. I have revealed you to the ones you gave me from this world. They were always yours. You gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything I have is a gift from you, for I have passed on to them the message you gave me. They accepted it and know that I came from you, and they believe you sent me. My prayer is not for the world, but for those you have given me, because they belong to you. All who are mine belong to you, and you have given them to me, so they bring me glory. Now I am departing from this world. They are staying in this world. But I am coming to you, Holy Father. You have given me your name. Now protect them by the power of your name, so that they will be united just as we are. During my time here, I protected them by the power of the name you gave me. I guarded them so that not one was lost, except the one headed for destruction, as the scriptures foretold. Now I am coming to you. I told them many things while I was with them in this world so that it would be filled with my joy. I have given them your word, and the world hates them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but to keep them safe from the evil one. They do not belong to this world any more than I do. Make them holy by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. Just as you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. And I give myself as a holy sacrifice for them so they can be made holy by your truth. The word of God for the people in God. Please stand as you are able and sing hymn number 533, He Lives.
Jesus lives today. He walks with me.
may be seated. That's a hymn I never get tired of singing. During this Easter season, we've been looking at Scripture through the songs of the Beatles, and I'll be honest with you, I prefer Elvis to the Beatles. Beatles are pretty good. But, Roselle and I were talking, we like Elvis. Y'all remember when I did an Elvis series? Some of y'all do. That's already been almost 10 years ago. Can you believe that? Yep, time flies. We're going to get some more Elvis in here soon, too. But we got our last Beatles song today, and we're in Hebrews 13. I'll begin reading in verse 8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings, for it is well for the heart to be strengthened by grace, not by regulations about food which have not benefited those who observe them. We have an altar from which those who officiate in the tent have no right to eat, for the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin are burned outside the camp. Therefore, Jesus also suffered outside the city gate in order to sanctify the people by his blood. Let us then go to him outside the camp and bear the abuse he endured. For here we have no lasting city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. Through him, then, let us continually offer a sacrifice of praise to God. That is the fruit of lips that confess his name. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls and will give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with sighing, for that would be harmful to you. Pray for us. We are sure that we have a clear conscience, desiring to act honorably in all things. I urge you all the more to do this so that I may be restored to you very soon. Now may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working among us that which is pleasing in his sight. Through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of God for the people of God. We'll begin with a trivia question this morning. What is the longest running stage show in the history of American theater? Cats. Lion King. Yep, you might guess those. You're not going to get it. That's why I ask trivia questions. It's actually the Carousel of Progress, which was originally built by Walt Disney for the New York World's Fair back in 1964. It's now a permanent attraction in Tomorrowland at Disney World. How many of you in here have rode that? Yes, of course, it's a classic. There's a great big beautiful tomorrow. Yeah, it's a theater you sit in. It rotates 360 degrees and you watch four scenes of animatronic American families. And the whole premise of the show is to show how technology has changed over the years. Telephones, vacuum cleaners, computers. And they're always having to update this ride because the scene that is set in the future quickly becomes outdated. The things that are newfangled, cutting edge, they become old hat because you and I live in a world where things are constantly changing. That has always been the case. But what feels different these days is the pace, the rate of change. I remember the first time I used the internet was in 1997. When I was a senior in high school, I distinctly remember going to the library of the school and logging on, and it was this totally newfangled thing. That was only 27 years ago. That's the blink of an eye to some of you in here. But kids who were born in 1997 or later, they're never going to remember the first time they use the internet. And those kids have access to more information than any of the humans who lived in the 10,000 years before them. It's constant innovation and discovery. Just last year, European researchers announced that based on 7,000 recordings of more than 400 pigs, they had made significant progress in understanding the meaning of their grunts. One scientist said, by training an algorithm to recognize the sounds, we can now classify 92% of pig calls to their correct emotion. Finally, this is the breakthrough I have been waiting for. Forget about a cure for cancer. You and I now live in a world where we might be able to communicate with pigs. Of course, my wife says she's been doing that for years already. But, I mean, it is incredible. It really is. Things have always changed, but now they are changing so quickly that we can barely keep up. And there's a lot of excitement in that. There is a lot of good in that. I think sometimes we overly romanticize the past. President Calvin Coolidge's son played tennis, got a blister, died a few days later because there were no antibiotics. That was 100 years ago. Things you and I take for granted today, medicine, air travel, refrigeration, those would have been considered miracles just a few hundred years ago. And so I'm not saying today that change is bad. I don't think that's true. But I do think sometimes it is scary. And there's a lot of people in our world today who feel unmoored by the change that they see around them. There's a sense that we have been displaced from our old way of doing things, and we don't know what's coming next. And so a lot of folks are frightened and overwhelmed. I think that's why there's so much mental illness, so much depression in our world today. I think that's part of why there's so much addiction, is because things are happening so fast and we can't take it in. So what are you and I supposed to do? In this passage of Scripture, the author of Hebrews gives us an answer to that question. Remember that Hebrews is this lengthy theological argument written for people from a Jewish background to explain how Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament law and prophecy. And even though the specifics are different, their situation is remarkably similar to ours, because this is a group of people who feel like the ground has shifted beneath their feet, and they don't know what to believe. And so the author of Hebrews tells them to cling to Jesus, because he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. What an amazing promise that is. In the midst of all this change, Jesus is the source of our continuity. He is our way. He is our point of reference. He is our comfort. He is our security. And I think that's worth celebrating this morning. We live because he lives. That is the good news of Easter. Sometimes we get that message confused. Sometimes we have read this to make it say Christianity is the same yesterday, today, and forever. But that's something different. I mentioned this last week, that you and I as Christians don't really have a religion. We have a relationship. And that doesn't mean we don't have traditions or rituals. Of course we do, and some of those things are very meaningful to us, but religion was never intended to remain the same. That's the mistake the Jews made during the time of Jesus. They had this elaborate system of laws, of sacrifices, of priests, a system with which the author of Hebrews was well acquainted because he uses that same language in this passage. But in these words, the author of Hebrews never claims that this system was evil. What he says is that without Jesus, the system is incomplete. I think that's a reminder you and I need this morning, that religion is not the same thing as Jesus. I hear a lot of Christians in our world today burbling, gurgling, grumbling, complaining, and they say,
We have changed things that were not intended to be changed. We've compromised our morals. We need to get back to the old time religion. That's how they say it. The old time religion. I've seen that phrase on church marquees, and I always wonder to myself, what is the old time religion? Does that mean we need to start burning women again for being witches? We need to start going on crusades. That's old time. No, I don't think that's what they mean. What they mean when they say we want the old time religion is we want church to be like it was when we were growing up. Because that's when we liked it, you know. That's when it was good. That's familiar to us. Not like all this newfangled stuff. And I get it. I get it. I get it. If you and I grew up seeing a minister wearing a suit and tie every Sunday, it is hard for us to listen to somebody who's preaching from a stool while wearing a t-shirt. If we grew up singing How Great Thou Art, it's hard for us to sing 10 verses of a praise chorus. I get it. The problem is you and I have confused style with substance. Because nowhere in the Bible does it say religion is the same. Yesterday, today, and forever. It says Jesus is the same. Yesterday, today, and forever. The problem is we have equated Jesus with how we do church. In the process, we have become guilty of that same idolatry as those to whom this book of Hebrews is being addressed. We're obsessed with our system. We're obsessed with our way of doing things instead of focusing on Christ. Y'all have noticed, just like me, that a lot of churches are struggling these days. A lot of churches have closed. Far fewer Americans go to church than ever before, and there's plenty of doomsayers out there who are saying, it's the end! Here's the truth. This is not the end of our faith. It's the end of a religious system. And while I agree that it can be scary and confusing at times, I also think ultimately this is a good thing. Because it reminds us that it's not our religion that's going to sustain us. In fact, I think you and I are living in a very exciting time to be the church. Yeah, there's a lot of change happening, but we need that change because it helps us mature and grow closer to the living Christ. You and I may change the way we do church. We may change the way we present the message. We may sing praise songs instead of hymns. We may even allow women to wear pants in worship. But Jesus stays the same. And the fact that you and I get so worried about that, oh, Jesus is going to disappear from culture. They're taking God out of our country. No, they're not. They can't. Jesus isn't going anywhere. That's what the author of Hebrews is telling us. Jesus isn't dependent on our old-time religion. You and I may prefer that, but Jesus can get along just fine without it. Speaking of which, the author of Hebrews also does not say that the Bible is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I hear a lot of Christians fall back on that old chestnut too. The Bible. That's how they say that one. The Bible. The Bible is what we need to follow. We've changed the Bible. Yeah, we have. Of course we have. We've always changed it. You know, for hundreds of years, Jews had this thing that they believed to be the Holy Scriptures, and then one day along come Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Peter, Paul, the person who wrote Hebrews, and they said, we got some other stuff we want to put in there. Scripture changes. That's not something we talk about a lot, but it's true. And our interpretation of Scripture changes. That's the whole point of this passage. It's not saying the Jews were wrong. It's saying we need more than Scripture. We need Jesus. I can't tell you as a pastor how many folks I have run into who have been put off of following Jesus because they've actually read the Bible. Now, I think maybe it's non-Christians have read the Bible more than actual Christians, but when they read the Bible, they find out it's sexist. There's things in there that are disturbing. Holy wars. Entire tribes being wiped out in the name of God. Men, women, children. And they say to me, how can I possibly affirm this? To which I reply, we're not being asked to trust in a book. We're being asked to trust in Jesus. There's a difference there. Y'all know I have a great respect for the Bible. I believe it to be revelation from God. But the Bible doesn't save us. And if there's a discrepancy between what I understand in the pages of Scripture and who I understand Jesus to be, I'm going to pick Jesus every time. I came across something recently from a guy named Jordan Harrell, and I want to read it to you this morning. He wrote, genocide is biblical, and loving your enemy is biblical, but only one is Christ-like. Slavery is biblical, and chain-breaking is biblical, but only one is Christ-like. Patriarchy is biblical, and countercultural elevation of women is biblical, but only one is Christ-like. Retributive violence is biblical, and grace-filled restoration is biblical, but only one is Christ-like. Segregation is biblical, and unity is biblical, but only one is Christ-like. And he concludes by saying, Christ transforms, not the Bible. Be wary of those who know one but not the other. Y'all ever know any folks like that? People who can quote the Bible backwards and forwards, but they're meaner than a junkyard dog. People who can give you a pious explanation of what the Scriptures mean all day long, but they never exhibit any of the fruit of the Spirit in their life. I've known some people like that. And this passage reminds us it's possible to be a very good, religious, Bible-believing person and still not get it. Here's what the author of Hebrews wants us to know. It is impossible to reduce a living person down to a set of facts. It is impossible to capture the totality of who Jesus is with words on a page. You may meet a stranger on the street, ask them if they know Aaron Britton. And you may say, let me tell you some things about him. He's a pastor at Talbot Park Baptist Church. He's a husband. He's a father. He's funny. He's very good looking. And that person, after you tell them those things, would know some stuff about me, maybe even some things that were true. But knowing about me is different than knowing me. Y'all with me here? In a world where so much is changing, when you and I get confused about what we believe or who God is, all we need to do is turn to Jesus. Because Jesus is our God. That doesn't mean we give up on the Bible, doesn't mean we give up on church, doesn't mean we give up on religion. Those are all good and godly things. But our world today needs more than a holy substitute. We need the real thing. We need Christ. He is the only one who stays the same. I love the old-time religion. I know we long for yesterday, but there's a great, big, beautiful tomorrow. So let's continue to put our hope in Jesus. Amen. Let's pray together. God, these words are challenging to us as they were to the audience 2,000 years ago who first heard them, because we have so mixed up our way of doing things, our way of practicing religion, our way of reading the Scripture with the living presence of Christ that it's hard for us to separate those things. It's hard for us to even admit or acknowledge that sometimes we have substituted our own rules, our own system, for a person who is capable of transforming us. But God, He is the only one who can do it. He is so much more than just words on a page, no matter how good those words may be. He is so much more than what we gather for on Sunday morning, no matter how good that worship may be. God, we thank You this morning that in the midst of everything that is changing, including church, including the way we practice our faith, that we can continue to come to Christ, who is the same. God, He is the one we need. We pray that we will continue to find our grace and strength in and through Him. Amen. I've had people ask me before, when you talk about relationship with Jesus, what do you mean by that? You mean coming to church? No, I don't mean coming to church. You mean reading the Bible? No, I don't mean reading the Bible. Those are good things. Do those things. I like those things. Having a relationship with Jesus, having a relationship with any person is different than our system, our way of doing religion. It's an interaction in which we are speaking, but more importantly, listening to who we believe is still alive and present with us, Jesus. And that goes beyond anything that you and I are going to come up with, even though some of those ways of doing things are pretty good. They're still incomplete. This morning, as you're sitting here, maybe you're hearing that and you say, well, I've got the Bible believing part and I've got the church going part, but I need the relationship. Come on down and accept Christ. Maybe you're sitting here this morning. You're saying, I want to be a part of a community who doesn't just want to invest in a system, but who wants to live in a relationship with the living Christ. We invite you to come as we stand and sing hymn number 576.
Jesus, Jesus.
Please join with me in prayer. Father God, you are the giver of all good things, and your word makes clear that every good and perfect gift comes from you. We ask that you accept these gifts and use them to your glory. May these gifts bring shelter to the homeless, comfort to the sick, rest to the weary, and hope to the hopeless. Just as you multiply the offering of fish and the loaves that were freely given for others, we pray that you would multiply these, our offerings to you, and accomplish with them more than we could ask or imagine. In your name we pray, amen.
You may be seated. I want to thank you again for being here this morning. As Robert Williams told me, one advantage to meeting at 10 is you beat everybody else to lunch. So you got lots of time to beat the Mother's Day crowd. But just a few things I want to remind you of. Our last Wednesday night study of Ephesians will take place. I don't care if you missed everything else. You can still come for this one week. Right, we're going to wrap it all up this Wednesday night, 5:30. Bring your dinner. Join us next Sunday, church anniversary, also Pentecost. So we wear red, visible red. And afterwards, we're going to have our luncheon in the social hall, free. All you got to do is sign up. If you show up here, there is no reason for you not to stay. You should be here. It's a free lunch. We just need to know you're coming. So please sign up on that sheet in the hallway. If you haven't done that already, it's going to be barbecue next week. So we like to have fun. Please be here for the anniversary. And then we're also, as part of that, as we do every year, we're collecting a special anniversary offering. If you have a box of envelopes, there's a special envelope in there for the anniversary offering this week. You will see that is going towards the endowment fund, but specifically towards our new roof. We have one already on the Christian Education Building, and we are in the process of getting another one that will go over the music suite. Personally, I enjoy it when huge cascades of water come bursting in through the roof because it just makes life more exciting. You never know when it's going to happen. You might be standing in the right spot. There shall be showers of blessing, right? But some people said maybe we should repair the roof. I don't know. So we're going to repair the roof. So please give towards that. If you don't have a box of offering envelopes, you can still give. Just write a check and designate it for the anniversary offering. Or there's some envelopes out here on the table in the hallway. One more thing. Mary Jane, Joe Porter have graciously invited all of you, everyone in this room, everyone in the church, to come down to their beach house in the Outer Banks on Saturday, June 8th. What I want is for hundreds of people to show up that day. I want every single one of us to be there, and I know I'm going to be there. I'm going to be standing on their front porch in my snorkel at 6 a.m., all right? So please expect me. They do want to count so that they can know how many folks are approximately coming. So there's a sign-up sheet on the table in the hallway. But isn't that nice that their offers are good? So come down. It's just going to be a day of fellowship. If you want to go to the beach, you can go to the beach. If you just want to hang out, I've been informed that there's a first-floor bathroom. So that's all you need to know, right? All right, so come. You can make a day of just that. So sign up on the sheet if you're interested. Let's stand as we sing one last time our Easter benediction, He is Lord.